Perfect. Okay, we continue with our session on module 10. We'll start again with this slide on clothing and commitment. Okay, so when we are negotiating, there are four outcomes. We can have I win, you lose, the first one, and then we can have I win, you win. Okay, and then we can have the third one, I lose, you lose, which means that there's no outcome. And finally, I lose, you win, which means that we lose out in the negotiation process. Okay, so the ideal is to have this one, I win, you win, and then you create long-term relationships. Okay, now we can go ahead and see how we can actually improve these long-term relationships in contract negotiations. When are agreements reached? Agreements are going to be achieved when both sides will understand and consider each other's viewpoints and interests. Now, this is important. It is essential for everybody involved to keep an open mind in order to achieve an acceptable solution. An agreement needs to be made perfectly clear so that both sides know what has been decided. The final stage is the point where the last few adjustments to the deal are made by the involved parties before closing the deal and placing trust in each other to fulfill their role and creating a working relationship for the future. Planning and preparing a negotiation is very important. Preparation starts with determining if this is a potential collaborative situation, so that you can select the better strategy, the strategies we discussed before. Next, you spend time researching information, analyzing data and leverage, and identifying interests and positions. Finally, you have to consider the relationship you want to build. Okay? In negotiations, it's always important to know that deal you are getting was going to be probably a long-term one. So, elements of preparations. Initial points to consider. Should I be negotiating? What I need to know? I need to organize the information. So, what to consider? For example, if you're a mining company, you are going to negotiate for a deal with a government, or if you are a government, like most African governments negotiate with mining companies. So they need to take information regarding what they want to get out of the deal. They need to know the extent of the deposit, and they need to organize their information and take with them some lawyers and some legal experts who can help them in the negotiating strategies. Okay. So the other part of preparation is research. So players and stakeholders, you need to research the company that you're going to negotiate with. You need to research also what they're involved in, what they've done before, and so forth, to know their experience. And you need to research the standards in the industry. What are the standards of negotiation? What are the benchmarks? Then you need to analyze the data, reorganize your data, anticipate what will happen, and assess strengths and risks. This is very important when you are actually preparing for negotiation. Okay, in most cases, African governments, they come out with poor deals with the mining companies. Okay, identify your and their interests, goals, most desired outcomes, least acceptable agreements, best alternatives to a negotiated agreement, concessions. So these are the issues that you need to take into account. You should know the relationship you want to build. Do you plan to build trust? You should prepare for emotional reactions. You should develop to probe and discover the things you don't know and to test assumptions. Okay? So, in negotiations is a very important art because what has finally been agreed will be in place for a long time. Okay? What is probing? Probing is the technique which is employed to encourage the respondent to give you a more detailed answer to a question and elaborate on his previous response. An example is, for example, you ask the question, anything more? And then, why do you think that is fair? So that they can explain themselves. Or, how did you come up with that solution? So these are examples of probing when you're negotiating. You probe the other side to see how far they are. Information exchange. There is what we call the go, no go. This is the time to make a decision. Are you going to decide yes or are you going to decide no? So the go, no go decision is when your assessment in this stage, the negotiation process, is negative. You make adjustments or implement your best alternative to a negotiated agreement. So the best alternative to a negotiated agreement is known as a partner. So if your assessment in this stage of the negotiation process is positive, you move forward. If it is not positive, then you stop the negotiation. With trust developed, you explore for creative solutions that address interests and see the potential to create real value. Okay, remember that in negotiations, there are two parties. Each party wants to get something out of the deal. So when you are concluding a negotiation, this is stage four, okay? This is when you have reached an agreement. It is important to find out if the other side has the capacity to follow through with the things they said they are going to do. This is the time to put down in writing a common interest and produce a comprehensive summary of your agreement. Sometimes you have to consider a strategy here to lock in a commitment. That means you put benchmarks so that the other party can also commit. We should be sure to agree on the next steps as well. And never forget to thank the other party for their willingness to negotiate, even if the outcome has not been what you think it was. You may meet them again some other time somewhere. Stage five of negotiation is called execution. In stage five, we execute the agreement or we implement the agreement. This stage may also be viewed as a preparation for the next negotiation opportunity. You must ensure that you follow through on promises made in order to strengthen relationships and to build trust. You will learn more in this stage about the other side. This will lead to an easier negotiation next time around, especially if it's going to be a long-term relationship. There'll be negotiations over and over again. And remember that during execution, you are likely to apply the total negotiation process and the best negotiating practices to unexpected events, failures in performance, and inevitable changes. Okay, so when an agreement has been negotiated, it may still need to be looked at over time. Okay, what about conflict management and strategies? Conflict in the workplace can be counterproductive. If it's not addressed properly, then any small conflict can grow and become a bigger problem. So there are steps to follow when managing conflict, even during the negotiation process. When executed properly, it can help to determine the reason for conflict and determine the resolution. So let's just look at it a little bit and find out what our alternatives are. The first thing is we should address conflict immediately. We should not allow it to persist. The second is, once you have made aware of a conflict, you should begin the process of addressing it immediately. Allowing a conflict to continue unabated only makes the problem worse because it will grow until the point where it is a serious problem. If the conflict is in a negotiation environment, it means that you're going to spoil the negotiation process. So you need to make sure that the conflict is sorted before negotiation can go ahead. Conflict resolution. Sometimes a workplace conflict is an important argument between two employees. In other cases, it can be a major conflict between two companies. You need to interview all the parties involved in the conflict and determine if it is something that is worth pursuing or if it can be resolved quickly on its own. This is a judgment call on your part, especially as the manager, and you should collect as much data as possible to make a correct decision. Yes. Let's go to the next slide. Okay. Before bringing the party into one room together to try to resolve the conflict, you should speak to each party privately and try to determine the reason for the problem. Each party may offer their own perspective on the reason for the conflict. So you will need to look at each side separately, determine the core reason for the conflict and what each side would consider a resolution. Okay, so conflict management is something that should always be addressed immediately. take a look at the information you've collected from both sides and formulate what you perceive to be a fair resolution. Get input from other people, such as human resources department, the third party manager's opinion value. The resolution you come up with needs to be fair to both sides, fair to the company. Okay, so you need to remove conflict immediately it comes up in the company. Okay, you need to bring all the parties together and present your resolutions of conflict. Be sure that you have laid out detailed reasons as to why you have come up with that particular resolution. Point out to each party what they've come to gain from your idea and why the resolution is fair. If it is a negotiation process, conflict resolution is very important. Okay, now let's look at the last part, which is handling multi-party negotiations, cross-cultural negotiations, and mediation and arbitration. United Nations and entities like the World Health Organization are routinely involved in multi-party negotiations. The African Union and the World Trade Organization are always involved in multi-party negotiations where African countries come to the table and often follow the world trend. How are these negotiations handled? Is there sufficient preparation? Multi-party negotiations can be incredibly challenging. Just ask the negotiators for the over 170 countries who managed to reach an agreement back in 2015 on a legally binding accord to combat climate change. The deal is aimed at reducing use of hydrofluorocarbons, a chemical coolant used in air conditioners and refrigerators. Okay. So these multi-party negotiations are the ones that we normally find in most scenarios which involve countries. So how do we go about them? The first part is to choose coalitions wisely. Who are you going to coalesce with? Amid the clamoring voices in the multi-party negotiations, it can be difficult to be heard. In such instances, you might choose to form or join a coalition with parties who share one or more of your goals. Coalitions can be powerful organizational tools that build on strength in numbers and multi-party negotiations. But as anyone who has watched the TV show Survivor knows, coalitions also can be difficult to handle. We should manage multi-party negotiations. Whether you are negotiating with 3 parties, 30 parties, or 300 parties, interactions in your multi-party negotiation are bound to be more complicated than when you are dealing with just one single party. Sometimes it makes sense to appoint a manager to oversee a multi-party negotiation. Manager can be in charge of putting together the group's agenda, setting rules, summarizing, understanding among parties, and communicating the final agreement to outsiders, among the other parties. So when you're having multi-party negotiations, having a manager, or at least key few people to go ahead and organize the negotiation is very important. In multi-party negotiations, you have to calculate the dynamic partners. As in a two-party negotiation, you should enter in multi-party negotiation with a solid idea of your best alternative to negotiated agreement, the partner. That is what you do if a deal fails to materialize. Knowledge of your partner can help you stand firm in the face of offers that fall short of your goals. You should also attempt to analyze the partners of the other parties at the table. Roughly calculate the minimum you can offer someone to secure a commitment. That is going to help you. Okay? In multi-party negotiations, the partner is always very important because that's the least you can accept. Okay, now we look at understanding contracts. How do we understand contracts? When you agree to do a job for another person or a business in exchange for money or some other benefit, you are probably entering into a commercial contract. If so, this contract is legally enforceable regardless of whether it is just a handshake deal or a written agreement. But a better understanding of the contracts you can enter into, you will be well placed to negotiate contracts that work for you. However, it is important to get professional advice to fully understand the obligation in the contract. Okay? What constitutes a contract? A contract refers to a commercial contract made between an independent contractor and the hirer. I think hirer refers to a person or business that engages an independent contractor. Sometimes a contract or a law will refer to the hirer as a principal. Commercial contracts may include a contract for the independent contractor's labor, or skills, where payment is made on the basis of hourly or paid rates. A contract for the independent contractor to achieve a result where payment is made on the basis of a fixed fee. These commercial contracts are different from the employment contracts that apply to employers and employees. Okay? So we are more concerned with these commercial contracts. Okay? Working with contracts is a large part of small business community. Once in place, the requirement of the contract dictates the way in which small businesses operate. In short, they underpin the viability and security of any business, large or small. A contract is an agreement between parties that sets out their respective rights and obligations for the period that the agreement is in existence. There are certain elements that all contracts should have in order to be valid and be binding. So we look at these shortly elements. Okay, these terms and complete, certain terms and complete agreement. An ambiguity in that, in the important terms of a contract is likely to make it unenforceable. For example, you cannot agree to a contract of sale if there are no clear defined price. There should also not be any question that either party has been forced or pressured into making the contract, and the subject matter of the contract would not be legal. For example, if A contracts with B to commit a criminal act, it is not a legally binding contract because it is illegal. Only legal contracts are binding. Okay, our last slide deals with the language used in contract. Okay, nowadays more and more lawyers use plain English in contracts, although there are some who still insist on using the old legal language. At worst, this can mean that some contracts are impossible for non-lawyers to read, and is not helped if the fact that the law uses a number of Latin elements. These two elements can make reading contracts a baffling experience for the rest of us. So what is important, therefore, is to ensure that you understand the language in the contract. What you do, any terms that are labeled in the contract that you don't understand, you should extract them, find their meaning. And once you have finished finding their meaning, you come back and see what the contract really means. So it is important that before you sign any contract, you understand all the language that is used in that particular contract. If you don't, there's also the part where you can contact someone to help you to understand the language. Thank you very much. This ends our course on money in the African context. And this was the module on contract negotiations.